to another episode of Binge Dash.
Hello, hello, hello.
This was Leo's idea.
It wasn't. I said it was an awful idea, but here we are.
You fully supported this idea like you support the idea of Kirk Cousins as a QB1.
Nope. He's trash. He is hot, hot trash. Garbage juice. As juicy as garbage can get.
All right, let's take this back a second. Rewind. All right, welcome to the first ever video pod powered by Bleacher Breaker, our new sponsor. Shameless plug.
www.bleacherbreaker.com. Some real good content over there. Check it out.
So this is what we're going to do today. We're going to run a little standard mock draft for you guys. If you recall two Podrick Paynes ago, we were talking about our draft strategies, so now you'll get a chance to see them in action.
Yeah, you'll get to watch us just destroy these drafts. Is it going to have computers in it?
Slay it. Smush the draft.
We're going to smush the draft. That's exactly what's going to happen. It's going to get real smushy. All right, well, let's just get in the draft, and then
let's jump in.
We'll start out. Yeah, we're both queued
up. So you'll
be
drafting from the fourth spot. I'll be drafting from the seventh spot. So you'll see two teams being drafted. And you can make a decision as to which team is superior, but I have a feeling.
And which one is Derek's? Boom.
Boom.
All right, I've entered the draft. I've hit the button. I am loading. I am in this draft at the fourth spot.
I am in this draft at the seventh spot. Looks like we are joined by two other people.
D-Rock. That's just a truly awful name. But here we are.
It is completely legit.
All right.
So what do we got? We have 5 minutes before the draft starts, so we might as well touch up on the fantasy news that's been blowing up in the past week, namely Le'Veon Bell. We haven't had a pod since Le'Veon Bell got suspended, or I guess he's likely to be suspended for 4 games to start the season.
We have not.
Yeah.
So let's just quickly
explosive news.
Yeah, the bullet points over this. So he's going to miss almost a third of the regular fantasy season, because that's only 13 games if you're in a reasonable league. Yeah, it's huge. We don't know what's going on with his knee either, so he might not even be himself when he comes back.
Yeah. And this is the second time he's been suspended for smoking the wacky tobacco.
Mm-hmm.
Who's to say that he won't do it again and get suspended even longer? We've seen this happen with Josh Gordon, who we'll touch on in a second.
Yeah.
So at this point, he's extremely risky, in my opinion, because D'Angelo Williams will start the season as a starter if he has a great first 4 games. I don't think Le'Veon's job is in jeopardy, but I think you might see more of a timeshare than you want to see if that happens to start the season. And at that point, you won't get your return on the first round pick.
No, and then you're kind of locked into trying to draft D'Angelo too, so you can make up for those 4 games. So you're spending two top six picks to lock up a backfield that could just be a timeshare after the first 4 weeks for who knows how long. It's definitely risky. Where would you take him?
Le'Veon, I would take him in the third. That's the earliest I would take Le'Veon Bell. And at this point, I don't think there's a chance that he makes it to the third.
No.
But if he is there, I'm taking him in the third. But I won't waste a first or second round pick on him because of the uncertainty level, not only with the knee, but with his, I guess, off-field behavior at this point.
Yeah, I don't think I'd have any trouble finding 24 players I'd rather have than him. So, yeah, I'd say third round, too, is probably...
Third round. All right, let me throw some names at you.
Okay.
Doug Martin or Le'Veon Bell?
Doug Martin.
Mark Ingram, Le'Veon Bell?
Mark Ingram. Mark Wahlberg's Instagram.
Exactly. Boom. Boom. There it is. Bench dash name.
Boom.
Let's go a little bit further down the line. Latavius Murray, Le'Veon Bell. Yeah, now you got to think about it.
I think about it. I might do Latavius Murray, maybe. I don't know. I'm like actually higher on Latavius than most, though, so I don't know if that's a good indication.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's a good spot to stop with the whole Le'Veon thing. But yeah, about third round, I'd say we take him.
Yeah.
Also, Josh Gordon has been reinstated by the league. He will also miss the first 4 games. Where do you take Flash?
Flash. Gordon, I'm personally not taking him till, I don't know, pretty late. because it's not like the last thing we saw was him being an elite wide receiver. He did that in 2013, but then in 2014 he came back and he was garbage. I think in points per game he was the 59th wide receiver in points.
6.1
yeah,
game in the five games he played.
Yeah, and if you stretch that out over a full season, he would have finished as like the 48th best wide receiver, like just not good. And that wide receiver gets drafted in the 11th, 12th round. That'd probably go a little higher than that because he does have number one wide receiver as a potential. But I probably would wait till like the 9th or 10th round to take him. But he's not going to drop that far.
Yeah, I might reach for him in the 8th, but the 9th would be ideal, 9th or 10th, like you said.
Yeah.
Because I think everyone kind of skirts over the 2014 season.
Yeah.
They're just so locked in on 2013, like, oh my gosh, he was a fantasy god.
Yeah.
And then they forget when he came back from one of his previous suspensions and played five games, he looked like just an average wide receiver.
Yeah, he doesn't really run very many routes. He kind of just goes deep and bullies people, which worked, but it doesn't work forever. So it'd be pretty late for me to take that risk.
So 9th, 10th round there. Mm-hmm. And right before the draft starts, let's touch on what just happened today. F. Scott Fitzpatrick is re-signed with the Jets.
Yeah,
there it is.
It's good news for the Jets wide receivers because we know that they can potentially do what they did last year. There's none of that what's going to happen with Geno's situation, but he himself doesn't offer much value other than a streamer who will occasionally post some good weeks and a good matchup.
Yeah. So are you drafting Fitzpatrick?
As like a streamer, I'd take him super late. I actually don't know who the Jets play week one. If it's a soft matchup, I would take him if the draft felt such a way that I was streaming. So.
Okay. Well, it looks like the draft is underway here. As you can see, it's starting off wide receiver heavy, which has been pretty common. I'll let you take over because your pick is coming up at number four.
My pick is next. So the first three wide receivers you usually see go went Odell, Antonio, Julio. Usually not in that order, but they're all kind of interchangeable, really.
Yeah.
We should say we're in standard format here. This isn't PPR. So for me, out of the guys that are left, Todd Gurley is my top player. He is my number one running back. I would have taken him number one overall, period, because I tend to be a running back guy. So that's actually a pretty easy pick for me. I'm not sitting here feeling like I'm going against what might be the better reason to take one of the top wide receivers. So I will easily lock in Gurley.
God Turley.
Move on, yep. God Turley.
So ideally, I'm sitting at number 7. I'm hoping that Adrian Peterson slides to me. I don't see it happening. We'll see if Snakes and Spurs grabs him right here, which would be a great pick, 5th overall.
Yeah, I'd be pretty shocked if AP made it to you. He might. People are pretty high on DJ and Ezekiel, so we might slide to you.
That's true. DJ might go.
And there he goes.
Nope.
Yeah.
See, I don't feel comfortable taking David Johnson. Well, I don't even have to make that decision.
Yeah.
So now it comes down to, do I want to take AJ Green or do I want to take Lamar Miller at this point?
It's really one of those two.
Or Jamal Charles. It's between Jamal Charles, Jamal About That Base, Lamar Azard Miller, or AJ Green, who doesn't have a bench-coined nickname yet.
Not yet. Give it time.
I think what I'm going to do here is I'm going to take AJ Green because I love AJ Green this year, because I know that a Martin or Ingram will probably make it to me
probably
on the way back in the second round. So I feel strong about AJ Green as my wide receiver one and then a Doug Martin or a Mark Ingram as my running back one. So that is the thought process there. And there goes Zeke. Yuck. At 8th overall.
Too high. That is... in his position, I for sure would have taken Lamar over him. But even like... I would have taken Hopkins. Yeah, Jamal for sure. Dez. Maybe even like Jordy and Robinson. But I'm like pretty low on Zeke.
Yeah, well, David Johnson and Zeke, they're high-risk picks in the first round. And that's not what you want ideally in the first round. You want that plug and play for sure will produce for you. You don't even have to worry about it in the first round. And yeah, Ezekiel Elliott has the upside potential, but we've never seen him play. And there are running backs. Nobody wants to talk about it because it's Darren McFadden and Alfred Morris, but there are other running backs in Dallas that could potentially take carries from Ezekiel Elliott.
Oh, yeah, we've seen this story before of he comes in, he's going to start out the guy, but he's going to have a short leash because he's a rookie. And so if he doesn't perform for the first couple games, then those other guys are going to start getting mixed in because the Cowboys want to win more than they care about him producing. So he'll end up in a committee, maybe eventually even, like, probably not get fully benched, but he could lose his job if he doesn't come out of the gate swanging.
Swanging. And even if he does get the majority of the snaps, if it's only like a 55-45 split, that's still not good first-round value. No. I know everybody wants to coin Ezekiel Elliott as the next Todd Gurley, and he is talented.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just too risky for me personally. I don't hate him as a player. In fact, I'm excited to see him play.
You hate him as a person.
Let's be honest. With the recent news that has yet to be verified, he might not be the best person in the world. But that's neither here nor there.
Dez, Le'Veon Bell going in the first round, like we said. No chance he makes it to the third. That's very high, I think, given the people on the board.
Yeah, I would take Lamar Miller. I'd take Jamal. Jamal Charles hasn't gone yet. People are afraid of Jamal this year.
He's going to be a steal, and I'm starting to like the 12th spot even more for what this guy might do, which is take Lamar and Jamal at the turn and just lock in two top five running backs potentially at the 12th spot.
Yeah, that would be a great turn if you had the 12th pick and you took Miller and Jamal there.
About that base. That's robust RB. Jamal about the base. Yeah, it's robust. Very robust. But Gronk at the beginning of the second isn't hateful. Just a little high for me.
Yeah, not something I would do. Ooh, Mike Evans going a little early.
That's a little early. But I would take Jordy or Robinson ahead of him. Keenan. I would take a lot of people before.
I would take Alshon over Mike Evans.
Yeah, I would too.
But I like Evans this year. He's a solid second round pick.
Yeah.
But I think towards the latter half of the second round.
Yeah.
Let's see. So I'm next up on the clock. So like I said before, I'm hoping for a Doug Martin or a Mark Ingram to fall to me as my running back one. Or Jamal Charles. Now, I don't think Charles will make it to me, but if he does, I'm just swimming.
That'd be pretty surprising. There's no way he makes it to you.
See if this guy goes Le'Veon and Charles.
Watch him auto-draft Charles, and then you can just go full tilt.
Yeah. Come on, 10.
Here it is. Oh, and there it goes. Is it Jamal? Is it? Oh, Jordy.
Oh, it's Jordy.
Wow.
Right, with his hiccup, Jordy. Still going early in the second round.
Did that guy just join, take Le'Veon, and quit? He's like, that's all I needed. Just got to take Le'Veon the first time out.
Or he accidentally took Le'Veon.
He's like, shit, fuck this. This draft's ruined. Yeah. See, this guy's going to take Jamal. He already took Hopkins. He can't wait till the third. Yep.
Can't wait till
the third round, so he takes Jamal. Good pick.
I'm guaranteed. Guaranteed one of Martin or Ingram, who I do prefer over Lacy. I know Lacy's all the rage. Freeman as well, who just went before. I think out of the two, I like Doug Martin a little bit more this year. Just he has a tough schedule, and he blew up last year.
Mm-hmm.
I have no problems taking Ingram here. I think they're both great, but I have Martin slightly ahead of Ingram. So I'll go ahead and grab Martin here. And with Doug Martin, I'll probably look at grabbing a Sims later on in the draft. Not too early, but Sims is one of those handcuffs that is worth owning.
Yeah, if Doug went down, Sims would become the three-down back there very likely and have quite a bit of value.
Yeah,
Sims is a popular zero RB target for that same reason.
Yeah, because he would take over the role completely, all three downs.
Yeah.
And he still has value on his own, too.
Oh, yeah, as a third-down back, he certainly will still get in there. Right now, I'm hoping Ingram makes it past this guy to me because I'd be very happy with both Ingram and Gurley coming out of the 1-2 punch. This guy's looking like he might auto-pick too. Eddie Lacy,
there you go.
I don't hate that pick. It's not a hateful pick. So I will say I'm going to take Ingram, but also I like McCoy quite a bit. I've been liking McCoy more and more as the offseason goes on. No more Carlos. They're talking about signing Reggie Bush, which basically means LeSean will be the guy.
Have no confidence in Reggie Bush?
No, none at all. So
former first round running back?
No. And so LeSean has the higher ceiling, I think. LeSean could finish as a top three running back. He's done it before. He could do it again. But he has a lower floor than Ingram with just the injury concerns. Carlos will be back, so it's not like Carlos is just gone. So in that case, I'll take Ingram.
Yeah, I like Ingram here. McCoy will probably get picked in the next three picks, I would imagine, because 1, 2, and 3 started off wide receiver.
Mm-hmm.
I would guess that one of them would take Keenan and start off wide receiver, either this pick right here or the next one will probably be for Keenan sure. Allen.
Yeah, I think both Keenan and Marshall will be gone before it gets back to me.
But if you can snag Marshall, oh, A-Rob, I forgot he was still out there.
Yeah, that's good value for A-Rob. Yeah, Marshall, I'd be very happy with if I could get him in the third as my wide receiver one, because after him, there's definitely a drop-off.
Yeah.
So we'll see.
We'll see what happens here.
Hopefully these guys go a little bit more running back heavy. Let's see. There goes Keenan.
And Amari. Okay, all three of them are going wide receiver. There's McCoy.
Are we looking at McCoy to start off the third? No, that's good value, though. I like that guy's draft so far. Odell and Cooper with LeSean as his RB1.
Yeah, that's solid coming out of the one hole. Now, would you have taken McCoy if he fell to you? Would you have started on running back?
Assuming I had both McCoy and Marshall, yeah, I think I would, honestly. Because to me, that's actually kind of the end of a tier. That, Ingram, McCoy, Martin, that's, the end of the, true RB1 tier to me. And so I think I would take it, yeah.
Yeah, ooh, Brandon Cooks. I like Brandon Cooks a lot this year. There you go. There's your Brandon Marshall.
There's my Brandon That's Marshall slipping to me.
Wide receiver one.
Easy pick. I'll talk about some of the others for a second because I got 40 seconds roughly to play with. T.Y. isn't a totally hateful pick here. You know, high ceiling. If you think the Colts are going to bounce back, then he is definitely the main guy behind it. Cam, awful pick here. Kelvin, awful pick here. Demarius would actually be a really good pick here too. If Marshall wasn't here, Demarius would be who I'd be taking.
Yeah, and actually that's who I'll take if he makes it to me.
Yeah, but I will lock in Marshall, and we'll see if your Demarius keeps
on
sliding.
Well, I'll take T.Y. before Demarius, but I'm assuming T.Y. goes next.
Explain that to me. Explain T.Y. over Demarius.
With A.J. Green, there's Demarius. Well, so my decision's been made for me. With A.J. Green as my first-round pick, I think he has a pretty high floor. I like the explosive upside that T.Y. Hilton brings coming in the wide receiver 2 spot. So I'll go ahead and take T.Y. Kelvin has been going a lot in the third round, which I don't really like. Mm-hmm. I'm not as high on Kelvin this year. I think his completion rate, his rookie year, was awful. And he scored a lot of his points in garbage time. I know Cam is talking him up this year, our offense is going to run through Kelvin Benjamin, but I just don't buy him in the third round. I much prefer guys like T.Y. Hilton or Demarius Targaryen. So T.Y. Hilton is my kind of boom wide receiver 2 here. I'm very happy with A.J. Green, T.Y. Hilton as 1-2, with Doug Martin as a solid running back 1.
Yeah. That's depending a good combo. Because Demarius would have been another high floor wide receiver 1, where that combo might win you some weeks, but it might not. Whereas T.Y., when T.Y. goes off, he usually wins you the week. So that's a nice pairing with A.J. I like it. Oh, Kelvin going there in the third. Man, I hate that guy's team. Zeke, Devonta, and Kelvin, that's just
It's not good. Yeah. I mean, and watch that team just explode if this was a real draft.
Yeah, in a real draft, that team wins the whole thing.
Yeah, of course, because, a rookie in the first round, Devonta Freeman, who fell off of a cliff at the end of the season in the second, and somebody who missed the entire 2015 season in the third.
Who was the least efficient receiver in the league during his rookie year.
Just terrible.
Really bad.
But he put up good fantasy numbers.
He did, I mean, he was good, but he was also awful. He was kind of like Blake Bortles. Forte in the third. Tell me what you think about Matt Forte this year.
Matt Forte is an interesting one. In the third, I don't hate it, but I'd take Latavius Murray. I'd actually take C.J. Anderson ahead of Matt Forte.
Oh, hot take.
That is a little bit of a hot take because of C.J.'s reputation after his last year, complete first-round bust. Forte, I think, because he was signed to a contract that's actually similar to Bilal Powell's, they definitely are planning on using Bilal Powell a lot. And I think it'll be one of those situations where it's not going to be a clear-cut backfield. They'll probably be full possessions where they'll just give the ball to Bilal. There'll be Forte possessions. Neither of them are really goal line running backs, so I'm not too sure what the Jets are going to do there. I mean, obviously Forte over Bilal in that regard, but I think there's just too much uncertainty with the usage for Matt Forte in the third. I don't hate him at the end of the third. I'd definitely take him in the fourth. But like I said, I would take Latavius before him because
he's
a clear cut.
Yeah, I would take Latavius over Forte for sure.
I'd take C.J. Anderson over him as well. Carlos Hyde. Ooh, I'd take Forte over Hyde.
Yeah. So. I will say that I think the most likely goal line back in New York is probably Kyrie Robinson doing the exact same thing he did to Ingram. Yeah.
Yeah. So, Roger, so here is going to be an interesting situation. There are still some running backs on the board, but the tier has completely shifted after we saw, I guess, Murray, if you want to include Murray in that tier, but after Murray went. We're left with C.J. Anderson, maybe as the last running back in the tier, and there he goes. So I'm going to see if I can get some value in the wide receiver field. And if Sammy Watkins makes it to me in the fourth, I'm going Sammy Watkins, again, with the upside. And he has the potential to be a top five running back. Oh, I mean,
wide receiver, but there he goes. Wow. So you got some difficult decisions to make.
So now, I don't like Langford here. There's just too much uncertainty again with the Chicago backfield. I know he's slated as a starter there, but I like Jordan Howard. I like his chances to come in and steal the job. Ryan Matthews would be the running back I'd take. So it's to me, it's between Jeremy Maclin and Ryan Matthews here. And I'm going to go ahead and grab Ryan Matthews in the fourth, which may be a little bit high. But the reason why I'm going to do this is because I don't know if he makes it back to me in the fifth round. And sometimes you have to make slight reaches to get the guys that you really want, because I just have a feeling, especially with a guy that's in the two hole that has taken three wide receivers to start, you kind of have to look at the board in front of you. I just don't think Matthews would have made it back. So maybe a slight reach there, but I do like Matthews a lot this year. Yeah. I know there's already news that he's, you know, a little bit banged up still, but I think by the time the season rolls around, he's going to be the clear-cut starter in Philly. So I'm happy there.
Just talking through my entire goddamn pick. Can't believe you're doing this to me. I'm going to have no time to go over it. I would take Jonathan Stewart, but I think he'll be here back around the other side, I'm hoping. So I'm probably going to go wide receiver because none of these other running backs are super inspiring. So it's either Maclin or not Edelman. A little too early for Tate. It's just going to be Maclin, I think. Yeah. Not the highest ceiling of the bunch, but his floor is incredibly safe, and he does have those blow-up games occasionally. So as a wide receiver, too, he's pretty solid.
And he's pretty much the only thing in Kansas City outside of Travis Kelce.
Yeah.
It's Jeremy Maclin.
Yeah, I would have taken I probably would have gone Doug Baldwin if he had slipped a little more. Not
because Dougie Fresh.
Dougie Fresh. Not because I think he's necessarily he's certainly not safer, but he has the higher ceiling. Which, again, Marshall, I think, is going to have a super high floor with Fitzpatrick back. So
Fitzmagic.
So it's kind of a similar thing of trying to pair a high ceiling with a high floor. But I got two high floor guys instead, but there will be plenty of high ceiling guys to come as the draft goes on.
Yeah, I like the floor of your team, definitely. Between Ingram, Maclin, Marshall, actually all four of your players provide a very high floor. So consistency won't be an issue there. Man, Jeremy Hill in the fourth, huh?
It's quite the reach.
Thomas Rawls and Jeremy Hill.
No, Jonathan Stewart. See, I got greedy.
There he goes.
I was like, oh, he'll make it to the fifth. His ADP is so low on Fantasy Football Calculator. And there it is. Maybe I should have done the reach, but I'll have to pivot. I'm looking at Matt Jones to be the guy I take if he can get a few more spots. Matt Jones. Matt Jones. if he doesn't make it, curl up the ball on the floor and cry to myself. If he doesn't, I'll probably just go Golden Tate maybe at that point. Just go a third wide receiver.
Values there for Golden Tate.
Yeah. Or Moncrief. It gets interesting at that spot because Golden Tate has the higher floor, Moncrief the higher ceiling. Maybe I'd go Moncrief. I don't know, man. Hopefully Matt Jones just makes it to me and I don't have to decide.
Deion Lewis. Yeah, he might. Who would I go here? I won't steal your airtime. I'll let you think this out. Tate's gone.
So really be looking at this is between Matt Jones, Moncrief, I would say. Yeah, because he's the number two in a presumably elite offense bouncing back. Julian Edelman's interesting. Just those first four games without Brady are worrisome. And after that, it kind of just turns into guys that aren't worth a fifth round pick to me. I'm kind of thinking Matt Jones for the upside, you know? He's one of the last high upside running backs left.
He's going to get all the touches in Washington.
Yeah.
All of them.
And he's a pretty talented boy. So I think I'm going to go Matt Jones.
I mean, he had terrible running back metrics last year.
But he wasn't, like, good on paper, but the upside is there.
But he's the de facto running back in Washington, so
yeah.
You go volume over talent sometimes.
Sometimes
you do that, not man. That he's not talented, but he had some issues last year.
He's just inconsistent is really his problem.
Yeah. Oh, my word. I'm in an interesting spot here. Now, because I have T.Y. Hilton, I don't know that I want to take Moncrief. I mean, they're both viable, definitely. Let's see here. This is going to be a little bit. My thought process is I'd probably take Michael Floyd or the running back hole. I don't like Ivory. I don't like Ajayi. One of these guys will probably come back to me in the next round. So mm-hmm. I think I'm going to get a wide receiver here. Now, do I take Moncrief or Floyd or Decker?
Decker's interesting, too. He's like a high floor guy.
Yeah, I think I'm going to take Decker, actually, here. Again, it might be a slight reach for Decker. I think maybe he makes it to the early sixth. But with Hilton already as a boom wide receiver, I do like the floor of Eric Decker. And now with Fitzpatrick back, I think he'll be a solid fifth-round value as a wide receiver. Well, on my team, he's a wide receiver three, which is what I like.
Yeah.
As a wide receiver two, I'm still a little bit iffy with Eric Decker. I don't hate him as a wide receiver two. I think he's a very solid wide receiver two, but I absolutely love him as a wide receiver three. So,
yeah, it's a wide receiver three with wide receiver two upside, and I think probably wide receiver two floor. Like, short of, yeah. like, Fitz getting hurt or that offense just, like, truly imploding out of nowhere, I think, like, wide receiver two is a very safe floor for him.
Yeah, and there goes Russ.
Russ in the fifth. That's, like, it's a bit much. I don't hate it because he does have overall top QB in his range of outcomes, but it's still, like, I still wouldn't have done it.
Yeah, I mean, really the sixth is the earliest that I would even take an elite quarterback.
Yeah.
And they don't seem to be lasting that long. So I don't think it's a oh my goodness, Foster in the sixth. All right.
Wow. This guy's a believer.
He's all in. Well, he took Ajayi and Foster, so he's just locking up the backfield.
He's like, I'm taking this Dolphins round pick.
He basically just spent a fifth and a sixth round pick on one running back or a timeshare, which is not a very good move in my opinion.
It's a timeshare unless you're sure that Foster is going to get hurt, because I don't believe Foster's the every down back, and the only way Ajayi ends up the guy is if Foster gets hurt. So it's you're banking on an injury when you do that.
Sixth round here.
What you got?
So the way I'm thinking is this: if I'm looking at the running back pool, I see Gio Bernard. Mm-hmm. I see Melvin Gordon. I see Frank Gore, who I'm not going to take. Amir Abdullah, the Abdullah Express.
Abdullah Express, choo-choo.
Choo-choo.
All aboard.
Oh, you know what? Mm. I'm going to take somebody I believe will have a great year.
Oh, shit. Who with it?
It's coming. It's who coming. It? The Duke.
Oh, shit.
The Duke
shit.
Of Duke Johnson.
Wow,
sixth
okay.
Sixth round. As my running back three, I think game script will be on his side the majority of the season. I think he has the potential to catch 60 to 70 passes, and I don't like Crow. So I think Duke Johnson will see a good amount of work in Cleveland.
Sure.
And they're, I mean, slated to be a run-heavy offense, so I think he'll be on the field a good chunk of the time. So I like Duke Johnson here. Again, it's probably a bit of a reach for Duke. I could have taken Gio there. I think most experts would have put Gio over Duke Johnson, but whew, I'm in on Duke this year.
Something wrong with that. I like that pick. It's good to take the guy who has guaranteed work. You know, if he is the guaranteed third down back, and if things go his way, he can take over the full-time job, whereas Crow, at most, is the early down back. He'll never get more than that.
Yeah. I mean, you could say the same about Gio.
Yeah, I'm going to make my pick, and then I'll talk about it. Melvin Gordon, I like him quite a bit this year in the sixth round. I think that's really good value for a guy that is the early down back there. He won't get third down work, but that's not really an issue. What he needs to do is start getting goal line work, which I believe he is a better goal line back than Danny Woodhead. I think what we saw last year was insane. And it's really just, you're banking on, will the Chargers be better? And they started off the year really good, and just the offensive line fell apart and the offense imploded.
Should be healthy, yeah.
Yeah, so it's betting on his talent, because I think he is quite talented. Every time I watched him last year, I was like, he looks really good, and he's just like inches away from breaking a big run. Just like never quite happened for him. So for the sixth round, as my RB4, I feel like it's a pretty safe bet, because even if it doesn't work out, it's not like I'm ruining my lineup with my fourth running back busting.
Yeah, it's an RB4. Nothing to complain about there, really. I mean, your take could have been a lot shorter. Melvin Gordon just needs to stop being awful, because he was awful last year. I mean, if you look at his numbers, he was the worst running back in the league. Look, by a lot of different metrics.
Look, man, metrics for sure are like whatever, they're fine. But you gotta trust your eyes sometimes. You gotta watch the tape. Watch the tape for once, man, and you'll see. He was electric with the ball in his hands, you know? Like he had something special. Now right now I'm hoping one of John Brown or Tyler Lockett makes it to me. Because I'll be very happy with them as a wide receiver 3. I did the same thing with Stewart, of gambling that it would make it around the turn. One of them will make it to me.
Here it comes. Lockett's getting taken right now. Although this guy already has 4 wide receivers.
He's going to go running back. He's probably deciding between Forsett. Forsett in the 7th isn't awful, actually.
There he is.
Forsett. So I'm sitting here. Tyler Lockett, John Brown. Who will I take? This is a difficult decision. One I've been faced with recently in an MFL 10. And it's tough because John Brown is kind of the wide receiver 3 in a more lethal passing offense. Lockett was probably the wide receiver 2 in something a little more conservative. If you'd ask me,
you're going to take Lockett.
Look, let me do the drama. Come on, let me build this up. Let me have this moment. Yeah, I'll take Lockett. I'm going to draft him. But let me, you know, if you'd asked me this a week or two ago, I would have said John Brown, because I thought I was more in on him. But when I actually started looking closely at Lockett's numbers and thinking about it, I think he's on, you know, the precipice of a monumental breakout, as someone once said.
Wow, that sounds like a familiar tweet that may or may not have just been blasted on the Twitter machine.
Yeah.
Deshaun!
And is your pick?
Travis Kelce. Oh, you know who's sitting here in the 7th?
John Brown sitting there in the 7th.
You know who else is sitting here in the 7th? One Delanie Walker.
You're going to do it? You're going to pull the trick on Delanie Walker?
I'm not going to pull the trick. I love Delanie Walker, as Leo will attest to, but yeah. I am going to go ahead. I'm going to make a bit of a surprising pick here. Actually, it's not that surprising. Let me just double check. How much time do I have? We're in the 7th round. Okay. I think the value is right for Jordan Matthews.
Oh, that's interesting.
Just
okay.
Because I think he will see a ton of volume. Mm-hmm. And if you look at his statistics, I know he got hated on a lot last year. He ended the year strong. He just wasn't what people drafted him to be.
Yeah.
And recency bias will tell you not to draft him this year. And he's sitting here in the 7th, and I think he actually has wide receiver 2 potential.
Yeah.
So I don't hate him as my wide receiver 4. I actually like him a lot in this spot. And it was between Jordan Matthews and John Brown. And I love John Brown. Actually, Bench Dash loves John Brown, Smokey John.
Even though we both passed on him. Yeah, we love him even though we both passed on him. For guys that are lower in our top 50 rankings, which means our rankings are faulty.
It's fluid. The top 50 is fluid. You know, fluid. It's always changing. Oh, Delanie!
See, we just had this conversation off air. You love Delanie, but the problem is with his ADP is that there's other guys that have more upside at their position and are more valuable. Like, were you really going to pass on Jordan Matthews and John Brown for Delanie Walker? No, you weren't. 8th round?
Oh.
Sure, that's a little less hateful, but it would have been a reach.
Hurts my heart a little bit.
That's fine.
Delanie.
That's fine. This is life. Deal with it.
Ooh. Target machine, Delanie Walker. That guy is just built like a Mack truck, too. He's just running people
over.
That's
like really good analysis.
That's it.
Really, really top-notch.
Hey, you were
stuff.
Spouting off about watching the tape. If you watch the tape on Delanie Walker, he just, it's buttery.
It's buttery. Sure. It's good to use buttery. Food analogies for tape. That's like really clear.
That's it. Juicy. Buttery. Steaming.
It's coming Let's back see. To you. Who are you looking at? 8th round.
8th round. See, I'm sitting on 3 running backs here. Who do we have? Still a little bit early because I like Eli. Oh, Carson Palmer's sitting here, which is interesting.
Not a bad value in the 8th. I would say it might be a very good value in the 8th.
If Carson Palmer makes it to me, I'm thinking about it for sure.
You will think about it, yeah. This guy's not going to take him. He just took Russell. Thing. Yep, there you go.
Gary Barnage, Barnyard Dog. going in the eighth.
Roof,
so roof. I got we're off the rails now. Carson Palmer in the middle of the eighth. Oof. This is where it's gonna make or break my team. Because if I don't get Sims, I'm gonna be very upset. I still think the eighth's a little bit too early for Sims.
I think you're probably safe.
I'm gonna take Palmer here.
From you, but you know.
Just to throw my draft into the toilet. I'm taking Palmer.
Plan. Okay.
Because he does have an explosive offense. And in the eighth round, we've always talked about the eighth round being right around the earliest we'd take a quarterback like Palmer.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in the sixth, if a Breeze or Wilson or Rodgers, Newton are sitting there, we're taking them in the sixth. But I like Palmer in the eighth here.
Yeah.
Typically... Yeah. Okay. It's your pick.
Yeah. Happily, let me talk. Yeah. You have your turn. Yeah, calm down. I'm really deciding between Kevin White and Marvin Jones. You know, who do I want as my wide receiver four in this spot? I think Kevin White has the higher ceiling, better player theoretically. He is also the number two in an offense that I think could do better. But Marvin Jones is a little more proven. He's not coming off of a season long injury. But I'm gonna say go for the upside. Why not?
K White.
Ooh,
I like
K.
it.
White. Yep.
I like K. White in the eighth. That is all upside.
Yeah.
And you have to remember, people tend to forget that Kevin White was being talked about in the 2014 draft as being ahead of Amari Cooper.
Yeah. Yeah, it was like a 1A, 1B kind of thing. It was like, well, Cooper is like a more polished route runner, but Kevin White is a more raw, like better athlete.
Yeah. And he missed the entire season. He kind of fell into obscurity a little bit, but... I mean, with Alshon there, Kevin White could see a hefty amount of targets. I know Jay Cutler loves Alshon, but Alshon is going to be the primary focus of that offense. Could open up the field for Kevin White a little bit if he can clean up his route running.
Yeah.
He has the physical tools. Oh, Torrey.
Oof.
Torrey
Smith. I like Torrey a lot. I probably wouldn't have taken him in the ninth, so I don't know why I'm upset about it. But I like Torrey, so I'm like, oh, man, I guess I don't have him.
I know. And the eighth's a little bit early. I would have taken Torrey in the ninth.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I didn't even see that Sims went right after I picked Palmer.
Yeah, man.
That was what I was talking about right there.
I sit here.
Straight. Oh, shit.
I don't love any of the QB value. Eli's interesting, but at this point, I think I'd rather just wait a little bit longer. Running backs, it's none of these guys really worth a ninth round pick to me. So it's kind of, do I take my fifth wide receiver? Do I swing for like a Marvin Jones or a Stephon Diggity?
Stephon Diggs, no Diggity.
Do I pivot and take who apparently is my boy, Ladarius Green?
Black and yellow.
Yeah, the black and yellow man. It's a ninth round, which is not a hateful place to start taking a tight end.
Yeah.
If you believe in his upside, the issue that I pause with is that there are plenty of other tight ends with very good upside that are a better value, like Dwayne Allen, Eric Ebron, but then I have to count on them making it back to me. They might not, and there isn't anyone else at this spot where I'm like, ooh, but I really want this player.
The suspense is building.
So it's really like Marvin as my fifth wide receiver, Ladarius is my tight end. You know what?
You're taking him, right?
I'm taking Ladarius. Boom.
There it is. The question is, do you believe in Ladarius in the ninth? I think Cher said it. Do you believe Ladarius in the ninth?
I mean, I believe in Ladarius more than you believe in Delaney is what we found out, basically.
Ooh. See, I still only have three running backs on my team. Now, ideally, I would lock up Tampa Bay's backfield, but Sims was snaked, which isn't ideal. Wendell Smallwood is not worth owning. Crow the ninth. Is Crow even on the board? He got taken already. What am I talking about?
Yeah, he went super.
So I don't like the running backs here. You know what? I'm gonna go a little heavy on the wide receiver field. I think Marvin Jones is great value in the ninth. So I'm just gonna go ahead and go for a value pick here, even though I'm a little light on running backs. But I mean, Marvin Jones over Kenneth Dixon. Marvin Jones over. I mean, if you look at what's left in the running back pool, we basically have the high upside guys that will probably still be there in the 10th. CJ Procise, Kenneth Dixon, and then handcuff territory with Chris Johnson, Devontae Booker. Ooh, Booker, my boy.
Devontae Booker,
the greatest rookie running back of all times.
Yeah, we're getting to that range of running backs where they're kind of all the same. They're kind of all these upside backups. So it's why would you reach for one in the ninth when you can wait and have a guy with just as much upside in another round or two?
Yeah. But yeah, Marvin Jones I love in the ninth. Tevin Coleman I did like in the ninth as well. I would have taken Coleman there.
Mm-hmm.
Blunt in the ninth. Sterling Shepard, that's a good ninth round pick. And there goes Diggs.
I guess I'm not – you're sold on Diggs. My only issue with Diggs is he's the number two in a very conservative offense. Like, how much volume is he going to see?
Well, you assume he's the number two because you think Laquan is going to come in and take the number one reps. But I think if you look at Diggs' numbers last year as compared to a lot of other rookie studs, then you think that he is just on this upward trajectory. And I think they are trying to get Teddy – more involved. I know this was the narrative last year as well. Okay, we want Teddy to throw the ball. They have Adrian Peterson. I think a key factor here is that their offensive line is finally healthy, and Teddy will have more time to sit in the pocket and throw. And obviously, opposing defenses are going to hone in on Adrian Peterson. Mm-hmm. So theoretically, if we're seeing an eight-man box, it should open up the field for Treadwell and Diggs. And I think Diggs has shown the explosiveness more so after the catch. So he's one of those receivers where he catches the ball and runs.
So a poor man's Tyler like Lockett, you might say.
A poor man's Tyler Lockett. There it is. Pop it and lock it again.
Yeah. The Tyler
driver. Diggs in the ninth. I like Diggs in the ninth. I feel like he's a forgotten man because the hype was so strong last year when he first came in and was tearing it up for the first couple of weeks. And then it wasn't even that he fell off. He just went back to what you would expect of a rookie wide receiver in a conservative offense.
Yeah.
He wasn't putting up 10 to 15 points a week, and people are like, oh my gosh, hype train is derailed, and he's kind of fallen off.
Who are you looking at here? Who you got?
Yeah. Jeez. Now I'm looking at who we have as a tight end.
The Arizona defense? The Seattle defense? The Denver defense?
See, here I'm looking at this guy definitely won't take a third tight end. So I have my quarterback locked up. Again, oh, DGB, all about that upside. See, this is the thing. Okay. There are still some great tight ends on the board.
There are.
I'm in that position where do I take a Julius Thomas here, who I do believe will have a tight end one season, or do I wait for like a Dwayne Allen later on? Let me see who else. I'm running out of time already. Wide receivers, Corey Coleman, running backs, Kenneth Dixon here. You know what? I'm taking Julius. I still think
Julius.
These high upside guys will be there in the 11th round for me. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to go ahead and lock up who I consider to be a tight end one this year in the 10th. I would have been happy with Dwayne Allen or Eric Lebron in the later rounds as well. Just peeking at the draft board.
So
here,
we've arrived at my pick. My sort of like flag quarterback that I'm looking at is Tyrod Taylor, Ty God. The issue is it's a little bit of a reach right here. The guys between me and my next pick, two of them already have quarterbacks. One of them doesn't, so we could definitely take Ty Goat. So it's a bit risky, but I look at who else is here. Are there any running backs I super love? Not really. Any wide receivers where it's like, oh man, I gotta have this guy. Not really either. So I think I'm gonna reach for Tyrod. Yeah.
Reaching for him, huh?
There it is.
Ty Goat.
It's a small reach, you know. He might have been there when it comes back around, but I don't feel like I'm missing out on anyone particularly special.
This is where we need the clip of the goat screaming like a human. Ty Goat Taylor.
Yeah.
Oh, there goes Gates.
There goes Gates. I like Gates this year, actually. He just, all he does is catch touchdowns. Hot analysis, well, but there does. It is.
It is. Hot takes.
Yeah.
Bench dash FF.
This guy is definitely going to take a quarterback.
Oh,
there goes Kirk Cousins. Yeah, see, he's awful. That guy's made a huge mistake.
10th round.
That's
a little bit high for my liking. Well, even though I'm all on Kirk Cousins this year.
Yeah.
Dixon.
See, I like Dixon, but it's like it's such a committee. The odds of him fully winning that job just feel really slim to me.
Yeah, because they also have Buck Allen there, who will probably be
the book
involved third downs, passing downs.
Yeah.
And they have Forsett, who apparently, according to camp discussion, is the guy in Baltimore. The guy.
Oh, so we're coming up on my next pick here. I'm done with quarterback and tight end. Not even going to look at it. Pretend like it doesn't exist for the rest of the draft. I'm looking at running back. Chris Johnson's a little interesting. Devonta Booker's a little interesting. We look at wide receiver. I still like Coleman, despite the Gordon news. Yeah. Travis Benjamin.
Willie Snead?
No, not really.
You're hating on Willie Snead, huh?
There's nothing wrong with Willie Snead. I just don't care about him. So I think I'm going to go Corey Coleman here, and it's because Gordon's going to miss the first four games. Who says he's even going to stay sober till then? And who says he's going to be good and not just end up suspended again? Like, Gordon is so risky that he might play three games this season. Who knows? Who knows? Coleman, the upside is still there. I like it. Taking the Coltrane.
In the 11th, there's nothing wrong with taking Corey Coleman, even with Josh Gordon being healthy. Yeah. And he's not, by the way. If you read the news reports, he's already, like, busted his hamstring.
Yeah, his conditioning is gone. God,
he hasn't seen the field. And by the time he plays a game, it will have been 10 years. What am I talking about?
10 years.
10 years, Josh Gordon.
Most people don't know Josh Gordon is older than Tom Brady.
All right, so I definitely need a running back.
Yeah.
I already have five wide receivers. I have my quarterback and tight end taken care of. I'm a little bit light on running back here, so I'm going to go for a high upside running back. Now, it's between Devontae Booker and DeAndre Washington. Mm. I do like Bilal Powell, though.
Bull.
You know what? I'm going Bilal Powell.
Whoa. Defend yourself.
Bilal Powell. Oh, did I time out? No, I got him.
You got him. Defend that heinous pick of Bull Pull in the 11th round.
I already talked about it a little bit earlier with the Forte.
No one remembers.
Take. No one. That was in round three. Come on. That was 8 rounds ago.
Yeah.
D-Rock, get it together. So Bull Pull, Bull. I think he will see a lot of work in New York. Forte is getting old. I feel like that's a narrative around a lot of running backs, though, and I don't really like it. I don't like that.
It's kind of brushing off a running
back. Yeah. Oh, he's old. Jamaal Charles is old. He's not going to do anything.
Yeah.
You know, any running back or wide receiver that's creeping up above the 30 mark is, oh, he's old. He won't perform. There's no other basis behind their take other than age.
Forget him. Is that all I need?
I don't even think I'll have time to touch on Bilal Powell. Okay, basically, I think he'll get a lot of touches. I think he'll see entire series and a lot, all of the third down passing work.
They, I like that
take. They used him a lot at the end of last year. If you remember when Ivory started to break down.
I don't remember any of it.
Booker!
You were hoping Booker would make it back around you.
I was hoping Booker. Oh my
God. DeAndre Washington is still there. You could do that.
That's exactly who I'm going to do.
Who are you going to do?
That's who I'm going to do. Doing little D.A.
Boom.
There it is.
DeAndre Washington is a good pick because that I think whoever that running back is in Oakland is going to be productive behind that.
Yeah, the offensive line is a beast this year.
Yeah,
I think a lot of people are kind of forgetting about the improvements that the offensive line made in Oakland this year, and the offensive line was already good last year. I think people are just afraid of Raiders after 13 years of God awfulness.
Yeah, it's a little unfair bias. It's kind of like how I honestly think a lot of Brandon Marshall being a third round pick is because he's on the Jets. I think if he was on like a bigger name team, he'd be going in the second round. It's a little absurd.
Cowboys.
Yeah, if he's on the Cowboys, he'd be a second round pick for sure. So yeah. I'm sitting here, and there's two running backs on this list that jump out to me. I already have them highlighted. So anyone watching this knows. Chris Johnson, because
CJ?
Because who knows that David Johnson is really the starter. I think that is like an unfair assumption. Beat reporters have even been saying that Chris Johnson is the starter, and people just brush it off like, nah, it's not true. I don't believe it. So it could be Chris Johnson. The other name that jumps out to me is Josh Ferguson of the Indianapolis Colts.
Ooh,
but
okay.
He's going to be around for a while, so I can wait on that.
Yeah.
So I'll just take Chris Johnson, talk about that a little more. Josh Ferguson is pretty much all that's there behind old man Frank Gore, who is, most people don't know this, 87 years old. on the precipice of just imploding. Yeah, first carry of the game of the season, he's just gonna collapse, and then Josh Ferguson will be the guy there, and anyone in that offense is gonna get a lot of scoring opportunities. So I like that.
Right, there it is. Frank Gore is gonna spontaneously combust when he receives the first carry of the year.
Yep.
So. Bench-take.
And with Chris Johnson, you know, I touched on it a little bit, but we don't know that David Johnson is a de facto starter. Chris Johnson was pretty productive before David Johnson went down. People play it down like he wasn't. Like, oh, he was fine. Chris Johnson was great until he got hurt. Yeah. And so
vintage Chris Johnson.
It was vintage. Yeah, he had some vintage runs. There was that one play where everyone thought he was down and he wasn't, and then he just, you know, that was vintage Chris Johnson. Crazy.
We're just gushing on Chris Johnson right now. It's a love affair with Chris Johnson.
I got to point out right now, Dwayne Allen in the 12th is great value for that guy.
Yes.
Dwayne Allen could be great this year for the same reason that Josh Ferguson could be great. So I support that guy's decision.
Making the tight end position great again.
Making it great again. So here we are in the 13th round. This is the last
Ryan
position
Tannehill.
Pick because 14th and 15th are going to be defense and kicker for us because we're not insane. Yeah. So I've got to think, do I want another receiver? Do I want another running back? I got five receivers, five running backs. I tend to lean more depth at running back because they are constantly dying.
it's a true fact.
And so of the list, do I go with Joshy Fergie? Or do I go with like Paul Perkins is also a good pick. Jordan Howard's a good pick.
Mm-hmm.
Buck Allen is okay. I kind of want to stay away from it because that backfield is so muddy. Tim Hightower, if I want to just handcuff Mark Ingram, but I don't, so I won't.
Yeah, you hate handcuffs. I think this has already been established.
I think handcuffing is reasonable in like an MFL 10, but
you hate it.
I hate it. It's like, I'm going to hold this guy for how long when I could be using that bench space to stash someone on the bench?
Oh,
no, bench
name
stash.
Drop. No, name drop.
Sure. So anyway, I got to choose one of these three running backs. Jordan Howard behind fat Jeremy Langford, Paul Perkins behind old broken Rashad Jennings, or Josh Ferguson behind the corpse of Frank Gore. It's actually kind of a difficult choice. I know you like Jordan Howard and Paul Perkins.
I do.
You didn't even know who Josh Ferguson was before I said his name just now, I've decided.
I'm pretty sure I was the one who, you know, turned you on to Josh Ferguson.
That's
Fergie Ferg.
For the Fergie. So I'm going to take Fergie here.
The chat logs will tell the story.
Sure.
I like Josh Ferguson. Josh Ferguson is probably one of those backs that will go undrafted.
Mm-hmm. Very likely.
There's a high chance that he goes undrafted. So keep an eye on Josh Ferguson as a waiver wire add, or like what Leo just did here, a 13th round flyer, because the 13th round is generally where you're going to get your last position player. Mm-hmm. Assuming you wait until the 14th and 15th round for a kicker and defense, which you should be doing. So far, we've seen some defenses. Oh, well, geez, what was the first defense taken? Carolina in the 9th? That's gross. We've only seen one kicker go so far, which is encouraging. But generally, the 14th and 15th round, that's where you should be drafting your kicker and defense. Do you concur, sir?
No. I'm a big fan of first-round kicker, second-round defense. Lock up what you know the kicker's gonna kick that ball, so get that, and you know the defense is gonna have to play defense,
right?
It's a guarantee the defense is gonna be on the field at some point, so
that's
guaranteed touches, guaranteed points, or lack thereof, you know. You took Jordan Howard, there you go.
Yeah,
it said you timed out on my end, but that's an okay pick.
Yeah, I had Jordan Howard queued up and ready to go. I like Jordan Howard a lot, like you mentioned. Langford is kind of the new Fat Eddie this year.
It really is, yeah. He's the new Fat Eddie.
Yeah, because he put on 10 pounds, and Eddie has kind of slimmed down a little bit. Or you can make an argument for Carlos Williams, too, because he put on all that baby weight.
Yeah, Fat Carlos, right?
Carlos, but he's suspended, so let's forget about him for now.
He's dead.
Yeah, I think everyone just assumes that Langford is going to be the guy because of Fox. Oh, Fox doesn't let rookies touch the ball. I think if you look at Jordan Howard's tape, he is perfect for a John Fox offense because he is a between the tackles runner. He's powerful. I think he has a chance of stealing the job from Langford, or at least cutting into his touches, because we saw Jeremy Langford struggle as a between the tackles runner last year. He averaged 3.6 yards per carry, I think, which is pretty abysmal for a starting running back.
Real putrid.
And he was getting all the touches once Forte went down. he was the man mm-hmm. in Chicago. So I like Jordan Howard as a 13th round flyer. I mean, there's a chance that after camp breaks, we see the depth chart. I drop him if he's not, you know, if he's just sitting, wasting away on the bench. Oh, I just timed out, but I got the Los Angeles defense. Okay, I don't hate that.
They have a good week one matchup. I forget who it is, but I remember seeing it and thinking, oh, the Rams would be a good week one streamer. Let's see what we got here. I have no idea what the schedule is right now, so I'm just going to take the Raiders. There we go.
Boom. There you go. The Raiders are playing New Orleans in first.
All right. Not the best for streaming. Okay. That's really bad. Forget I took the Raiders defense. But, you know, I could just drop them.
But the Raiders defense has improved significantly. Sure. And once they get Aldon Smith back in week 10, they're going to have one of the best defensive lines.
They can handle the Saints in New Orleans for sure.
They can handle. I mean, their secondary is vastly improved. We got one Sean Smith. Okay. We got D.A. We got Reggie Nelson and Carl Joseph as our first round safety.
Scar J.
We just went all the way back to Scar Joe. Okay, I like
it. Just found a way there. I've seen an interesting thing people talk about. I've never done this in a draft, but don't draft a defense or a kicker. Take two more position players and then just wait to see how the preseason shakes out. And then drop two guys for kicker and defense right before week one.
I actually like that because I typically view the 14th and 15th round as a throwaway pick anyways.
Yeah.
And if you have a chance to grab like a Josh Ferguson, a Jordan Howard, or another one of these high upside players that have a chance, then you might as well take them because you don't know what's going to happen in the last week of preseason or right before week one, essentially. Yeah. Some news could break. There could be injuries. Oh, my. I'm timing out automatically, but I mean, I'm getting whatever. Josh Brown.
You got Josh Brown.
It works. I mean, I needed a defense. I needed a kicker. But back to the strategy you're talking about, I kind of like that, actually.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting. I think the further out you are from the start of the season, the better that strategy is. Like, if you're drafting a few days before the kickoff of the first game, then, like, it's probably not worth it. But if it's, like, you're drafting, like, week two of the preseason, like, I kind of think I'm on it. I think it's a good idea.
Yeah, week three is typically where we'll draft in our leagues, right after week three. And there is a slight chance that something goes down between week three of the preseason and week one of the regular season.
Yeah.
Typically, week four of the preseason doesn't mean a lot, but, I mean, why not go for it? I mean, it's not going to hurt you, basically.
No, it's not like you're missing out on that defense you were hoping you'd get or that kicker you'd hope you'd get. Yeah. Like, it's just, there's no reason not to. So I think I'm definitely going to do it. In our ESPN league, we're in together with the casuals. Wow. I'm going to insult them, hoping they're watching this. The filthy casuals.
Look at that. LeBron going in the 15th round. That is insane value right there for a tight end.
That's crazy. Man, that guy just won the draft getting Eric Ebron. I didn't even realize he wasn't taken. That guy wins. Woo. Best draft, even though he took the Jets.
Not only does he have Eric Ebron, he has Delanie Walker. What a tight end duo. Give him the... Order the rings. Order them rings right now.
If you look at the 15th round and you're just like, oh, Ebron, that's good. But then you start to scroll up. Okay, yeah, it tells me the draft is over. And you see like, oh, Jets defense. That's a little weird. Okay, oh, already took Delanie Walker. Oh, he has Breeze and Derek Carr. Oh, wait, his team's garbage. So he's kind of lucky.
Two quarterbacks, two tight ends. You know, it's against the grain. But he's zigging when others are zagging. You can't really fault
him. He's really going to like come out on top with those two quarterbacks and two tight ends.
Well, maybe he thinks it's a 2QB league.
Hopefully.
Yeah,
so let's review the board real quick before we wrap this up.
Let's make some general comments on our teams. I'll let you go first.
Yeah, so I'm looking at my team here. My running back core is God Turdley, Mark Wahlberg's Instagram, Matt Jones. I don't have a nickname for Melvin Gordon.
Flash.
Flash Gordon. Even though we use that for Josh Gordon, now it's Melvin Gordon's nickname. Sure,
let's
Flash
just
Gordon.
Steal it.
Vintage Chris Johnson and Fergie. I'm pretty happy with that running back core because it's very safe with the top two. And then there's going to be volume with Matt Jones and Melvin Gordon. So even if they don't produce at a high rate, they're going to get me something. So they're good insurance. And then you get the upside guys at the end with Chris Johnson and Josh Ferguson. If they don't work out, it hurts me nothing to cut them. And then with the wide receivers, we got Brandon Marshall, Jeremy Maclin, Tile Driver.
Tile Driver, there it is.
K-White, K-Spice. what I'd say for what is Coltrane for Coleman.
There it is.
Which is also, I also like, because Marshall and Macklin have a very high floor. Lockett and White have that super high ceiling. And Coleman is just like that flyer, you know, let's see what happens. Let's see if he ends up the number one in this offense after all.
In the 11th round, too. That's solid value.
In the 11th. Then I got Ladarius in the 9th, which now I'm looking at Dwayne Allen sitting there in the 12th. I'm like, man, I should have waited and taken. I wouldn't have gotten him in the 12th. I could have gotten him in the 11th. But then what else would I have done? I don't feel like I missed out on anyone super vintage in that area. Yeah. So I think that's fine. Tyrod in the 10th. Tiny bit of a reach, but I believe in him.
He might have gone, actually.
Yeah.
Who's to say that Kirk Cousins wouldn't have been Tyrod Taylor if you left him on the board?
I gotta think it would have been because Kirk Cousins is awful.
that is incorrect.
So it would have had to have been Ty Goat, which, you know, he... I think when you're taking those late-round quarterbacks, you're not looking for, like, a... I'm looking through the names trying to find an example. Like, you're not trying to get, like, a Tannehill or a Dalton or one of these guys that have, like, a decent floor but their ceiling is super capped. You want one of those guys that has like a pretty good chance of finishing as a top five quarterback if things fall the right way. And Tyrod is, yeah, and he's one of those guys just because of his legs, because when Sammy is healthy and in the offense, he puts up very good numbers. And is a 10th round pick. So if it turns out he's awful, I just drop him and hit the wire. So
it's funny you mentioned that about, you know, when Sammy's healthy, he has a weapon, because there's another quarterback that when he has a deep stretch the field type of weapon,
sure,
puts up insane fantasy numbers, and he goes by the name of Kirk Cousins.
I don't.
When DeSean Jacks,
sure,
was healthy last season, here Kirk Cousins put up fantasy numbers at a Tom Brady like clip.
Oh, so you're saying Kirk Cousins is the next Tom Brady? There it is, boom.
No, I'm not saying Kirk Cousins is the next Tom Brady. I'm saying Kirk Cousins is Tom Brady.
He already is Tom Brady.
Tom Brady light, and if you can get him in the 10th, well, the 10th round, yeah.
That's a little bit
of
a
reach. What? I'm all in on Kirk Cousins. If you can get Kirk Cousins in the 10th round, take him.
That's, yeah. No. I just, like, okay, 12th round, I don't hate it. I don't think it's the worst in the 12th round, because then at least it's, you know, you're basically at the end of your draft. That's fine. The 10th round, come on, man. Ty God is there. We're seeing guys like Romo was taken in that same area.
11th.
Yeah, Matt Ryan, I think, has some upside just because Julio is there. Derek Carr is someone that you're supposed to believe in as a Raiders fan, so you should automatically think he's better than Kirk Cousins.
Yeah. I love Derek Carr's arm. The only concern I have with Derek Carr is that JDR loves to run the ball. He likes to build his teams around the running back. You saw him try to do it last year. The problem was that they literally only had Tay Train. So they gave him the ball at an enormous rate, and he started to wear down. We saw him wear down not only as the season went on, but as each game went on. And if you look at his yards per carry average throughout the course of a game, it basically takes a nosedive in the second half. So he'll start off the game strong with fresh legs. And I guess that's a knock on Latavius Murray, is that maybe he doesn't have the greatest durability, that he wears down quite easily. But I think where DeAndre Washington will come in and help him is he will take some of the load off of his shoulders on third downs.
Sure.
Should keep him fresh throughout the game. And I think with an improved defense, we're going to see a shorter field for the Raiders offense. We're going to see better game script for the Raiders offense, because they were never really in the position to put games away on the ground. And if they're actually ahead, then Latavius Murray's value skyrockets.
Sure.
Because the Raiders are one of those teams where, I mean, they were playing from behind a lot last year.
So. It's very true. And for the uninitiated, JDR, of course, stands for Jason Delano Roosevelt. So go ahead and tell me about your team.
Bam. Tell me, okay, I'm going to be frank.
Gore?
Coming in the 7th spot, I would say I don't love my team, but I don't hate it either. Mm. It has potential. There are some clear weak spots. Now, I did something I don't normally do in drafts. That's taking a wide receiver as early as the 7th. But I think just depending on how the board falls, you have to be open to that idea. We've talked about this in our draft strategies. I can't go in locked in like, oh, I have to take Lamar Miller here. And I really do like A.J. Green to put up a monster year. I think his involvement in the offense will be right around 30% again. He'll catch about 30% of the total passes in Cincinnati, which is about his career clip. Last year, he dropped down to about 26, so I think he'll go back to his career norm. And I think without the secondary receiving threats in Cincinnati, that he'll have a great year. So that was my rationale behind drafting A.J. Green first overall. And I also mentioned that I was fairly confident that Doug Martin or Mark Ingram would come back to me, which they did.
Yep.
So as a 1-2, I love the combination of A.J. Green and Doug Martin. Actually, if I'm looking at my team, the first three picks I like a lot.
Yeah.
I like A.J. Green. That's I like Doug start. Martin. I like T.Y. Hilton. Ryan Matthews is one of those picks which could blow up in my face.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I thought he was the best runner in Philadelphia last year. He has always had potential, but he's always had the capability of falling apart, if you want to put it that way.
Mr.
So
Glass.
high potential of injury is what I should be saying. So that's kind of boom or bust for me there, but I do like Ryan Matthews this year. Eric Decker I like in the fifth. Now, where my team kind of falls off a little bit is probably when you look at the sixth round. As a third running back, Duke Johnson isn't terrible, but it's definitely not ideal. Because with the makeup of my team in a two running back, two wide receiver, and a flex, it's probably leaning towards starting three wide receivers every week.
Yeah.
Which I'm okay with.
No, there's nothing wrong with that.
With this team. If I can start a Doug Martin or Ryan Matthews or even Duke Johnson, if the matchup is right, then I'm more than happy filling in my flex with the Eric Decker, Jordan Matthews, or Marvin Jones. And then we fill it out with high upside guys like DeAndre Washington, Jordan Howard. Bilal Powell is kind of that handcuffy third down back that could take the job. Like if Matt Forte goes down, I think Bilal Powell will, he won't necessarily be a workhorse, but he'll see the lion's share of the touches.
Oh, and you're confused. He's on the Jets. Yeah.
Yeah. we're falling apart here.
Yep.
The wheels are coming off.
They've been
the video
gone for
pod.
A while.
Yeah, it's late over in California. It's still midday here in Singapore. Yeah, that's pretty much all I want to say. I love Carson Palmer in the eighth. Julius Thomas, like you said, looking at Dwayne Allen going in the 12th, I probably could have waited, but that's something you can't really predict when you're drafting. You can't be like, oh, well, I can just wait three rounds and get my tight end because you don't know when a run is going to start.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes you do have to make reaches like that. So Julius Thomas, I do believe, will be a tight end one this year. So I like him in the 10th. Overall, I'm happy with my team. I don't think it's the best team on the board, but I think it's definitely a workable team, a competitive team, and with the right moves on the waiver wire, would most definitely win a championship like last year.
Wow. That's like quite the leap out there at the end. So basically what we're saying is we have the two best teams on this board. Every other team is absolute garbage. I'm going to quickly glance through the board and see if there's any other team that jumps out at me. Or I'm like, ooh, this guy really killed the draft.
Yeah, I was just going to ask, who do you think won this draft? I'm looking at the other teams.
I'm immediately going to eliminate everyone that took a quarterback in the first six rounds. Just at a glance, I don't really love any of those teams. I just don't even feel like they got super great starts.
I liked RRG's first three picks, but then they went and took Andrew Luck in the fourth.
That he took Stewart in the fifth. That's like he's trying to make up for taking Luck there in the fourth.
His team's not bad. He reached for a tight end a little bit. I know everyone loves Colby Fleener this year, but
yeah, and he took a defense and they took Seattle defense in the 10th, which is you just
so
don't do
he's
that.
He's equal parts good moves and bad moves.
Yeah, he's got a good start to his draft, and then it just kind of falls apart in the later rounds. I don't hate number 11's draft. Besides the Ajayi Foster back-to-back picks, that was a little questionable.
Yep.
But the first four picks, Dez and Mike Evans, it's a nice idea. I would have taken a different receiver there, but going receiver heavy early, I don't hate. And Tate Train, the two Murrays, Tate basically, Train. Murray and Murray, isn't an awful 1-2 running back punch.
And then as a number three, he basically locked up Miami's backfield.
Yeah,
He's probably taking Ajayi and Foster with the hopes that Foster goes down. And he's guaranteed a starting running back out of the two of them. That's his mindset at this point.
Yeah,
and then he goes for the boom of all booms, Josh Gordon in the seventh.
Which like actually isn't like, we value Josh Gordon a few rounds later than that, but the consensus is like sixth or seventh round at Josh Gordon. So that's not actually not like a terrible spot. It's just we're a little bit lower.
Hate on him for that.
No,
but I wouldn't have done it myself.
No. Especially then Derrick Henry, which I guess he's handcuffing DeMarco Murray, figuring one of them will get the much vaunted Tennessee backfield. Gotta have that Tennessee backfield, apparently. Tavon Austin, I like, but I like him in best ball, but it's really hard to like him in a regular redraft like league with in season management, because when are his boom weeks? When do you know to start him?
Yeah.
I like Romo in the 10th though, but then why do you take Winston in the 12th?
Right afterwards. That was questionable. I don't think we can say that there was a clear cut like dominant draft by
team. Obviously, mine was the
ours. I mean, outside of the bench staff.
Oh, true. Outside of the clearly best drafts, the other 10 drafts. Yeah, none of them.
Like 12 had so much potential, and they just dropped the ball. They took Lamar Miller at the end of the first.
Yeah,
they could have taken Jamal Charles.
Yeah,
even a wide receiver.
Yeah,
they could have taken a Evans or a Jeffrey or A-Rob or Allen, and it would have been better than taking Gronk. I mean, it sounds like we hate Gronk, which we don't, but...
I hate Gronk.
I don't... Yeah.
I hate him.
Every single Patriot.
If you replace Gronk, just replace Gronk with Jamal Charles for a second, just for fun, and then he gets, Landry as his receiver one, which I don't hate. I would have taken Sammy instead. Hyde is his third running back. I get. That's fine. Then Moncrief. Roethlisberger in the 6th is a reach for me. He could have just taken someone else and instead taken Eli in the 9th. Eli in the 9th is okay.
Roethlisberger is somebody I think is going to disappoint a little bit this year.
Yeah.
He has Antonio Brown, so he'll be able to put up numbers with Antonio Brown, but he doesn't really have very many weapons outside of Antonio Brown at this point. Le'Veon Bell is suspended. Okay, you're gonna jump all on the Ladarius Green train.
Ladarius Green.
If you look at the other wide receivers there, who do you have? Marcus Wheaton, Sammy Coates,
Ladarius Green,
DHB, Ladarius Green,
Ladarius Green.
Well, with that depth chart, you have to think that Ladarius Green is gonna see a heavy amount of targets. So, I like Ladarius Green. Oh, I'm not hating on Ladarius Green.
You've been peer pressured into my way of thinking.
He's no Delanie Walker, though.
Well, Delanie Walker is going two rounds earlier, so it's not even a comparison.
Well, it is a comparison because he'll have two times the numbers of Ladarius Green.
We did have our bet that we should mention on air to make it official.
Yes, let's air this out.
It's just Delanie Walker versus Ladarius Green. Who has the better points per game as long as they both play 10 games,
to keep it
fair, so it's not that one of them plays
sample size fair. It's like two games.
Have two hot games and then out rest of the season, but their points per game are so high that then they can't be touched. So assuming a good length season of at least 10 games, points per game. If not, season long total. We'll see who wins. Obviously, it's going to be me. We haven't decided a punishment or what the bet is.
We should take this to Twitter. Actually, we should not only put a poll out there. Who would you rather have, Delanie Walker or Ladarius Green? But we should ask the masses what they think a punishment would be.
Punishment. To spoil it a little bit, I did put out a poll like a week ago that was Delanie Walker, Kobe Fleener, and Ladarius Green.
Delanie Walker won.
He won, and Ladarius Green lost. So that's like a good preview of how the poll's going to go. We'll do it again, though, just because a lot has changed in the last week.
Everything has changed.
And then we'll... and then we'll figure out what the punishment is. I stopped listening after you said the poll, so I don't know what the plan is for the punishment.
I will figure it out later. It's still early. We haven't even hit preseason yet.
That's true. We got plenty of time. One of them's going to tear their ACL in the first week of training camp anyway, so it doesn't matter.
We might not even have the bet, really. It could all fall to pieces in the preseason.
Yeah.
It'll probably be something with public embarrassment.
That's usually a good way to go. It doesn't cost anyone anything other than their dignity, which is,
Maybe just walk around screaming the name of the winning tight end out in the public space. Ladarius! That will not happen. You'll be screaming Delanie. Cut it to Delanie.
What was it called in Game of Thrones when Cersei had to do her walk of shame from the Sept of Baelor?
Walk of Atonement.
Walk of Atonement. Yeah, you have to do a walk of atonement screaming the winning player's name.
Do we have to be buck-ass naked, though?
No. This is like a... a ceremonial walk of atonement.
Extreme.
No. Actually, just like a just like in spirit. Yeah, sure, big dick swinging.
Darius!
Just in spirit. Because
that wouldn't get us arrested or anything.
Maybe like if we want to go really far, you have to like get a white shirt and a Sharpie and write the winning tight end's name on it. And then you just look like an insane person walking down the street. Maybe we go that far. We'll see.
We have to keep in mind, I live in Singapore. So there's a lot of things that if I even attempt to do, I'll probably just get straight up deported or arrested, one of the two. So you never know.
Well, let's hope that's the case.
Might have to keep it tame. I don't think I'm going to have to worry because it's all but guaranteed that Delanie Walker will win this bet.
That's because I mean, so untrue.
He has everything going for him this year.
He's on an awful offense. He has the worst, the lesser quarterback. So what? So he's on an awful offense, lesser quarterback. They're going to try to go run heavy because they don't have any real passing attack. You're counting on.
They've always tried to go run heavy. This is basically
But now they have DeMarco DeMurray. Yeah, but they
DeMarco DeMurray.
They didn't have DeMarco DeMurray last year.
What was it that you were saying off? I think you said it off air, so nobody got to hear your spiel about how young quarterbacks seem to just find their guy and use them as a security blanket. That is a perfect scenario for Marcus Mariota, Delanie Walker.
They
if you
do
looked
that
at how they went last year. No, you're making faces at me, but you know it's true. You know it's true.
They did that in their first year when they're new and they're scared. But now Marcus, in his second season, he's got the confidence of having piloted the Titans to the worst record in the league. And you know, now he's going to come out big dick swinging. And
there it is again.
And he's going to spread the ball around. Now he has that confidence. Whereas, whereas Big Ben is sitting there, he's got Antonio. And then what does he have? What, is he going to throw to Marcus Wheaton, Sammy Coates, and Darius Haywood Bay?
He has Antonio.
Yeah, but Antonio can't catch literally every pass.
I think the stats say otherwise because he's basically been catching every single pass.
Yeah, but he's not a real red zone threat. He's like 5'3". Darius Green is 7 feet tall. So
proven. Look it up.
Proven.
These are real numbers,
all
right?
Let me
give my spiel on Delanie Walker.
All right, let's hear it.
Real quick. I just have a couple more things to say about why Delanie Walker is going to finish as.
Sure.
Okay, I mentioned tight end one. That's jumping the gun there. Okay, let's be real. I'm gonna reel it back. I'm gonna pump the brakes a little bit on Delanie Walker. I'm gonna say he finishes as a top five tight end this season, and here's why. Now, people like to hate on Delanie Walker because they think his numbers. Okay,
I raised my hand.
I see you. Now that we're actually doing a video pod, I can see you raising your hand.
Yeah, I was doing that before, by myself, and it didn't really work.
The narrative is that his numbers are unsustainable, basically. That he's never been this good, he's going to regress. But then the same narrative is saying, oh man, you take Gary Barnage, that's great value. How does that work? How do those two things match up together in the same conversation? Oh, he's never been this good before, he's going to regress. Gary Barnage has had literally one season where he's produced out of five or six. Now, if you look at Delanie Walker's in the past three seasons, he's been a tight end one in the past three seasons. I think people have forgotten that last year, not the 2015 season, but in the 2014 season, he was a tight end eight. And he put up almost 1,000 yards in 2014. And people are going to say, oh, you know, this is completely unsustainable. But I think he's in line for even more targets this season. Because like I said, Mariota leans heavily on Delanie Walker. What did I say earlier? He's built like a Mack truck. That's an
intangible
stat.
That was
Look it up.
Yeah, look
he's
up the Mack truck.
He's basically a wide
stat.
Receiver. Yeah, look up. He's number one on the Mack truck. Definitely. You know, forget Gronk or any of these other stout tight ends. He's number one.
Number one.
But before we run way too long, just draft Delanie Walker if he is there in the. Okay, I'm gonna say it. Take him in the seventh.
You just didn't take him in the seventh.
I just didn't take him in the seventh. Okay, you're right. I won't take him in the seventh, but I'm saying somebody else take him in the
seventh.
I don't want to be put in the position where I have to draft Delanie Walker. I love Delanie Walker, but I don't like people on my team that I love because then when they fail, it just hurts that much more.
So you don't want
to. That's
like,
why I don't draft any Raiders because I hate having that conflict when I'm watching a Raider game. Like, come on, give it to Latavius. Oh, they scored a touchdown, but it wasn't Latavius. I hate my life.
That's why I picked Tyler Lockett, because the Seahawks are going to get all the touchdowns through the tile driver.
That's it. Tyle Driver is going to be
Tyle Driver.
Wide receiver one.
The season. Wide receiver one, yes.
Oh, the. Not a wide receiver one, but the wide receiver
is that
one.
That much more ridiculous than saying Laney's going to be the tight end one? It is. It is a little bit more ridiculous.
Okay, one more thing I want to put out there before we end this. What do you think about taking Le'Veon Bell in round one, Tom Brady in round two, and Josh Gordon in round three to come up with the all-suspended all-star team where you just, you're living on a prayer. Living on a prayer. Or Le'Veon on a prayer. It's an app name for that team. Until week five, and then your team will just be lead.
Well, despite the very strange way you framed that.
I mean, the amazing.
I think it's the smartest idea you can do. Just completely punt the first month of the season because everyone knows that doesn't actually count.
Yeah, it's only four.
It's only four games. Whatever. Sure, there's only 13 in the regular fantasy season, but whatever. Punt four of them.
Yeah, like 9-4, bro.
Yeah, and spend your first 3 picks because then, you know, why would you instead take Bell in the second, Brady in the sixth, and Gordon in the seventh where you can actually
just
get
think
them?
Think about it, though. If Tom Brady can reproduce his greatest fantasy season, Le'Veon Bell can reproduce his greatest fantasy season, and Josh Gordon can stop smoking the ganj and reproduce. Well, that applies for Le'Veon Bell as well.
Yeah, but that's two ganj smokers. For all we know, Tom Brady's a ganj smoker. We don't know.
Yeah, he probably uses deflated footballs as a bong.
Just boom, that's actually what happened. He was taking a little bit of air out of that football to fill up his bong, and now he got caught.
This pod is disintegrating. All right. I think we need to cut it. Right, need to say anything else?
No, I think that's it. We'll repeat once again. Thank you to our sponsors, Bleacher Breaker.
Bleacher Breaker.
Supporting us. You can find us on the Twitter at bench-ff. Like and subscribe to this YouTube channel where you watched it. Also bench-ff. Share with your friends. Tell your parents. Tell your grandparents.
Tell your kids, tell your wives.
Hide your kids, hide your wives. That's not outdated at all. It's still relevant.
Didn't that just happen?
We'll wrap it up. I don't remember what we say. All right, you got your Bernie. I'm going to hit stop recording. I didn't hit it yet. Now I'm going to hit it.
Oh, no.